Hi, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for this session of the K-12 Blackboard Innovative Teaching Series. The K-12 Blackboard Innovative Teaching Series is designed to help K-12 educators reimagine education with Blackboard teaching and learning solutions. The K-12 Blackboard Innovative Teaching Series harnesses the power of our K-12 community of academic leaders, teachers, and other experts to provide relevant, real-time, on-demand, and ongoing professional development opportunities for K-12 educators. My name is Katie Gallagher. I'm the Senior Product Marketing Manager for Blackboard's Teaching and Learning Products. I'll be serving as the moderator for the K-12 Blackboard Innovative Teaching Series. Thank you to Colleen Smith from our K-12 marketing team who'll be helping answer questions in today's chat. We'll be joining you for the series this fall as your host. We're always open to new ideas for topics for the series, so please let us know if you're interested in presenting a future session this spring. You can always email me at katie.gallagher@blackboard.com. Just a little housekeeping before we go on. If you could mute your lines using *6 or the mute button on your phone, we'll be recording today's session and we'll have a cleaner recording that way. We like the sessions to be very collaborative and love to have participation as we go. So please type questions into the chat to send to all participants or use the Q&A to engage and interact. And we'll feed questions in throughout as you bring them to us. Each webinar in this series will be recorded. You can search for the K-12 Blackboard Innovative Teaching Series playlist on the Blackboard TV YouTube channel. Or you can use tinyurl.com/bitsk12, and you can access all of the recordings there. You'll receive the recording of today's session and the presentation slides in a PDF after the webinar by email in a few days, and you'll receive an invitation to participate in a professional learning community on course sites designed to augment this series and create an avenue for ongoing collaboration and dialogue. So please accept this invitation and participate in this new online professional learning community. As you can see, we have many exciting professional development sessions lined up. Here are just a few to look forward to soon. Please join us on next Monday for From Zero to Blended with DeEdgebro, Timothy Gwynn. Next Monday session is at a special time, as you can see, at 4 Eastern Standard Time. Most sessions are at 3:30. And we have a special session next Friday as well on badges and personalized learning. So you can go to bbb.blackboard.com/k12bits to register for any or all of the sessions within the series. And be sure, if you haven't done so already, to download the new Blackboard K-12 Live app for PD on demand anytime, anywhere. You can catch the best sessions from Blackboard World this summer, and you can also access the recordings from this series. We update them on a regular basis after these sessions. So be sure to get this app if you haven't already. We're so pleased to welcome Jeff Simmons and Lisa Berry from the Idaho Digital Learning Academy today. They're going to lead us in Blackboard skills to pay the bills. Jeff is the Instructional Manager for Idaho Digital Learning. He's served as a teacher and administrator in the field of online learning since 2002. Prior to working full-time at IDLA, Jeff taught social studies and English at 2 different alternative high schools. He has a BA in social studies and English education from Northwest Nazarene University and an MA in education leadership from the University of Idaho. Jeff lives in Nampa, Idaho with his wife, son, 3 dogs, and 1 cranky cat. Lisa Berry is the curriculum manager for IDLA. She's been in online education since 2005. She's also worked as an adjunct instructor for Boise State University, teaching both face-to-face and blended formats, as a middle school mathematics and computer applications teacher. She has a BA in mathematics from Linfield College and an MS in instructional and performance technology from Boise State University. She's currently working on her EdD in educational technology through Boise State as well. So please welcome Jeff Simmons and Lisa Berry. We're very excited for their presentation today. So with that, I'll hand it over to our leaders. And as I mentioned before, If you wouldn't mind using *6 to mute your lines, we appreciate it for the recording. And we look forward to a great session. We'll be keeping an eye on both the chat and the Q&A. So please, you know, flow in with the questions so we can keep the session engaging. And thank you so much, Jeff and Lisa. I'll hand it to you now.
Thanks, Katie. Hi, everybody. This is Jeff. Can you guys hear me okay?
I can hear you great, Jeff. Thanks.
All right. Perfect. Well, we're glad to be here with you this afternoon, and thanks so much for joining us. So we're going to talk today a little bit about some of the things that our IDLA teachers do in IDLA courses and how they're able to leverage the different tools in the Blackboard suite to do those things. So before we get started, Katie gave you our nice professional bios here, but we wanted to introduce ourselves a little bit more. So this is me. This is our latest Simmons family selfie. This was at the rodeo back in July. So in Nampa, where I live, which is just a little bit west of Boise, we have a rodeo that's on the national circuit, the Snake River Stampede. So this was us at the rodeo last year. I started teaching online back in 2002. That's when I started working in Blackboard. I think we were on version 6.1 then. And then I started working full-time for IDLA here at the office in 2007. I started as a social studies curriculum specialist, and now I serve as the instructional manager. So in that role, I oversee the teacher side of our academic team, which includes our professional development program, our dual credit program. We have an e-tutoring program, assigning courses to teachers. I work closely with our supervision team. I oversee all of our full-time teachers. So all of the teacher-related stuff on the academic team. And I'm going to go ahead and flip this over and let Lisa introduce herself as well.
Hi, my name is Lisa, and I'm not going to read everything that's there, but I see my picture got a little distorted, but that's something that I do for fun, is also our whole family, but riding motorcycles. So that was a picture of me when I was in Montana earlier this summer for a ride.
Okay, so we'll, real quick on the agenda today, I'll give you a real brief overview of IDLA and who we are and what we do, just to kind of help you get some perspective on how we utilize Blackboard to deliver online courses. Lisa will give you a quick background on the development of our teacher evaluation rubric, and then Lisa and I are going to take turns going through the different categories on which we assess teachers and the different Blackboard tools we use to allow them to do those things. So I'll start with the about IDLA. So we are the state virtual school for the state of Idaho. We work collaboratively with all of the public schools and public charter schools in the state. We were founded back in 2001, began offering courses back in the fall of 2002, and we offer courses in multiple delivery models. Most of our courses are cohort classes where students start and end at the same time and have regular due dates throughout their course, and they progress through the course on the same pacing. Those courses we deliver through Blackboard. We also have some other delivery models that we've started to include. We have a hybrid model that includes some synchronous sessions along with the regular asynchronous content. We have some flex courses that have an open entry model for students. We also have a blended learning program. With that program, we work with districts and schools around the state that are looking to implement blended learning as the solution for some of the challenges that they've had in their district. So we'll provide not only seats within an LMS and content, but also professional development on how to build and facilitate blended courses and some blended learning pedagogy. And we have some other services that we will provide. We have regional coordinators throughout the state who are our boots on the ground in each region. They'll provide some strategic planning. My team provides professional development not only to IDLA teachers, but also externally to other educators in the state. And those are a quick snapshot of our teachers and principals. We have 282 part-time teachers, 5 full-time teachers that work on my team. We also have some full-time and part-time principals, and then I think 32 is the official number of staff here at the IDLA office. Our office is based in Meridian, which is right next to Boise.
All right, so IDLA back in 2006 chose to begin using a rubric to evaluate the teachers. That rubric was really based on best practices and was designed to encourage teachers to use those best practices as they were teaching. And to even more encourage them to use the to meet those expectations or exceed those expectations, there was some financial motivation. So the teachers are paid for performance if they earn 70% of the eligible bonus points, and you'll see how those bonus points work as we move through the presentation. They receive a bonus pay. It's a per student pay that I believe is $30. So if they earn that bonus, they get a $30 per student. So if they have 10 students in their class, they get a $300 bonus. If they have a 30-student class, then they get the larger bonus. And that rubric is used by our principals. As you saw when Jeff was talking about IDLA, we have a number of principals. They go into every class once every 2 weeks to evaluate the teacher based on this rubric. And then at the end of the semester, based on what their points are, that bonus pay is issued or not issued. So the first category in the rubric is the administrative requirements. And in this particular area of the rubric, there is no bonus points eligible for them to earn points towards that bonus, but there are a number of expectations that a teacher needs to make. If they do not meet those minimum expectations, then they are at risk of not being assigned a class in the future. So these expectations that they need to meet are, for administrative purposes, fairly straightforward. They need to follow policies in the employee handbook, code of ethics, and follow our acceptable use policy. They need to submit all of their required documents and paperwork in a timely manner. They need to meet teacher login and availability requirements. And what that means is they need to log in 5 out of every 7 days and be available for students to reach them via phone or email on a regular basis. They need to document all their communications just kind of as a protection in case there's an issue that comes up later. Teachers need to provide necessary accommodations for students on IEPs or 504s, and that also includes ELPs as well. They need to assess student work according to the established rubrics or scoring guidelines. And then if they find that they are going to be absent for some continuous amount of time, they need to make sure that that is appropriately communicated with the students, so the students can plan appropriately. And that could be something as simple as going camping for the weekend and not being online for 3 days. Another category on our rubric is for announcements within the course. So the minimum expectations here are that teachers post 2 announcements a week at a minimum. Teachers are encouraged to share instructional information in an engaging manner. So it's more than just an announcement saying, hi, I'm still here, keep doing your schoolwork, kind of a thing. It should provide, at least some of them should provide instructional focus beyond general information, can either set the stage for future learning, make connections to previous knowledge. But either way, it should model a culture of academic writing, so using that professional tone and so on and so forth. So those were the expectations. If a teacher chooses to go beyond expectations, here are some of the things that they can do to get one of those bonus points. They can include a podcast, video cast, voice announcement, or some sort of an interactivity to set the stage for future learning. And as it says in the little green cloud there, some of the Blackboard tools that can help with that are using the voice authoring mashup tool or the YouTube mashup tool. There's also podcast tools that they could use or video tools that they can record outside of Blackboard and then share their own announcements and videos in there that way. The next category in the rubric is the course and curriculum. And for this part, to meet expectations, they should report any curriculum or course concerns in a timely manner. I apologize, that looks like a typo there. They should work to create a culture of academic writing through modeling. And they should require students to support responses with evidence from content, the reading, or other materials. So this kind of gets at the heart of the Common Core when they support their writing with evidence. And then to exceed expectations and potentially get bonus points, a teacher can work with the course development team, which is the team that I oversee as the curriculum manager, to significantly revise or improve components of the course. They also could create or integrate new instructional materials into the course. And that can be any number of things. And as it shows in the green cloud there, the Blackboard tools they could use are blogs, discussion boards, wikis, to get students to interact with each other. They can use assignments or tests to have graded assignments and assess the students. Or they could link to other websites and include other instructional items in the course. The next category on the rubric is grading and feedback. And we have some fairly stringent expectations here. For the minimum expectations, we expect that the teachers grade assignments within 3 days of them being submitted by students, that at least one assignment per unit receives some specific detailed feedback, so more than just a good job, that feedback does model academic writing, so again, more than just a good job, but an explanation of why they did a good job. And the final one there is clearly indicate which assignments have that detailed feedback for students. And we do that in the Grade Center by just adding an asterisk to the name of the assignment being graded so that we can then train our students to look for feedback in those particular assignments. So the Blackboard tools that teachers use for that is obviously the feedback area within the Grade Center. Some of them, especially foreign language classes, like to use the voice authoring mashup just to give some oral feedback to students. Like I mentioned, voice authoring for foreign language classes is particularly helpful, helps students learn the proper pronunciation of the words and that kind of thing. And then also teachers can send emails through Blackboard to let students know about feedback. To exceed expectations in the gradebook area and providing feedback, there are several areas where teachers can get points. The first one there says that all students will receive specific, detailed, individualized feedback on two or more assignments. So the minimum was to have one assignment per unit. This is to have two or more assignments per unit. The next item listed there really leads to best practices. So any assignment that received less than a 70% if those assignments all have individualized feedback, then that can help the students improve their learning, fill those deficits. The next one on the list there says that assignments are consistently graded within 2 days of submission. So that just kind of shortens that window a little bit, gives those students even more immediate feedback, helping them minimize their misconceptions. And then if they consistently grade assignments within 1 day, they can get an additional 2 points on that bonus rubric. And Jeff, I'm going to hand it off to you.
All right. Thanks, Lisa. And as Katie said, if anybody has any questions as we go, feel free to type those into the chat or the Q&A, and we'd be happy to clarify anything for you. I'm going to talk about asynchronous communication and collaboration first. Between the gradebook feedback and the asynchronous communication, I think those are the two areas that have the most potential for a teacher to earn bonus points. When Lisa and I are referring to bonus points, on the rubric that our principals use to assess teacher performance, there's minimum expectations and the exceeds expectations. There's points available in those exceeds expectations, and if an instructor earns, I believe, up to 70% of those points available for exceeds expectations, that's when they qualify for that bonus pay. These are important areas that we've targeted because we see these two areas as areas where that have the highest impact with students. So asynchronous communication and collaboration, this is going to include discussion boards, wikis, blogs, voice boards, anywhere in the course where we have a collaborative component that's asynchronous. We have one of these components in every single unit of every course that we offer, so this is another reason why it's a high priority for us. And aside from participating, we ask that our instructors are personable, professional, pleasant, and the other thing that they need to do is adopt different roles to try to keep these activities moving. So in a discussion board, it's my job to maybe play devil's advocate sometimes. It may be my job to rein the discussion back in because we're getting out in the weeds. It may be my job to jumpstart the discussion. But it's my job as the teacher to really adopt the role that's necessary, depending on how that activity is rolling with my students, to make sure that that continues. And then in addition to that, again, the focus on creating a culture of academic writing, so that common core piece, making sure that we're modeling the expectations that we have for our students of using academic vocabulary, and renaming post titles and replies and things of that nature. So the tools that we use obviously are the asynchronous discussion boards within the courses. We do use the blog and wiki tools. I would say, I'm going to guess probably 80% of these are discussion boards, just because those were traditionally what we had, so that's what we used to build our courses around. But we do have a good number of courses that take advantage of the blog and wikis. We use a lot of the voice boards in our foreign language courses because in those course opportunities, students can not only type to interact, but they can also record a response. And in foreign languages, it's important to make sure that we have that speaking component available. So we'll use the voice boards in foreign language and in speech classes primarily, although teachers have the opportunity to convert any of their discussion boards into a voice board if needed. Exceeding expectations in this area, if the instructor just has a really good presence, if they're using different questioning techniques to reframe that discussion or extend the topic, that's an area where they can earn a bonus. I clicked a little quickly there. But we try to weigh that on the instructor's performance, not necessarily the student response. All right, communication. Since our courses are offered all online and at a distance, communication is really important, and this includes both asynchronous and synchronous communication. So within the first 2 days of class, we ask, that's actually been updated to the first week, but within the first week of class, our instructors are asked to make a phone call home. So just like in the face-to-face classroom, you want that first phone call to be a positive one. We want to make sure that each teacher has touched base with each of their students at least once by phone, and if possible, talk to mom or dad when they have the opportunity to do that. So we prefer that to be a phone call, but it can be an open house or something held in a synchronous room like this, like a WebEx, or in our case, we use Blackboard Collaborate. And then during the course, our instructor makes at least one other contact. So it could be a midterm. It's likely right before the final exam. We have proctored finals, so the instructors will call home and make sure that the students are set up to have their final exam proctored at their school. And then for any student who has an overall grade less than 70% for two consecutive progress reports, so two consecutive units, at that point we ask them to conduct an intervention. And prior to conducting the intervention, they have to either contact the parent or the site coordinator, who is an individual at the student's school who can work hand-in-hand with that student. A question on how many students are typically in, I'm assuming you're meaning in one of these online courses. We try to cap a course around 30 students maximum, if possible. 30 to 35 is kind of what we found is the ideal class size. We try not to run a class if it's less than 10 students, just because the interaction isn't strong enough to make it a great student experience. I think our average class size is 18, if we look at all of the courses that we ran over last year and the total enrollment we had in those courses.
Hey, Jeff, there's another question that came in, so go ahead and ask you now. What's the average length of experience for online teachers? 1, 3, 5 years?
That's a good question. I have that data somewhere, but not in front of me. I'm going to guess that our average length of experience is probably 5+. We don't have a lot of turnover at IDLA. Most of the turnover we have is either based to, you know, somebody becoming a mom and having life changes that way, or moving, or you know, taking on a different role at their face-to-face school. So most of our instructors stick around. So I think we're right around 5 years for average length of experience. But I could look that up and get that to you later if you'd like. So the other basic communication requirements that we have, we do ask that any communication sent to a teacher be responded to within 24 hours. That doesn't necessarily mean they need to have the answer. So if a student is having a technical issue, for example, it doesn't have to be resolved within 24 hours. It would be great if it was, but the teacher needs to at least return the communication to say, hey, I've sent your request on a tech support, or let them know what's going on. They need to have some return communication within 24 hours. And then again, the academic writing component. So asking that that our instructors are modeling what we expect with Common Core. And so the major tool that we have available to support this, aside from, you know, making phone calls and using our Gmail system, is Blackboard Collaborate. So similar to this tool that we're in today, that's an online synchronous tool that the instructor can use. They can host an open house or have office hours available. A lot of the intervention and e-tutoring activities occur within Blackboard Collaborate as well, to help remediate kids or provide help where needed. Okay, to exceed expectations, there's the open house piece. We'll also have instructors that will send out a midterm. So they'll take the time to use the reporting system within Blackboard and generate a student-specific progress report. The progress reports that come out of our SIS just give an overall grade and comments, so similar to what you would get, you know, in a hard copy progress report. But using the reporting system in Blackboard, an instructor can pull down something that you might see in PowerSchool or something similar to that, where it actually has a breakdown of all the assignments. They can make that into a PDF and then send it over to parents and schools to really give them good feedback on how their students are progressing through the course. We like to reward that. It's a good practice, so we'll make that available for a bonus point as well. synchronous. So our course content and most of our course activities are asynchronous in nature, but we do have a synchronous component available. And basically what our synchronous requirement is for our instructors is just to be available. So we ask our teachers to be available for 1 hour per week, and it can be in a variety of formats. It can be just as an office hour, so they can make available their Blackboard Collaborate link in their classroom. We call Blackboard Collaborate Idaho Live. I need to have 1 hour of Idaho Live office hours available to my students. In case students need some synchronous help, that's an option for them. We also have what we call the Academic Help Center, and that's kind of the next step of that. So instead of just making myself available for my Algebra 2 class, I can make myself available for all math students. And instead of using my Mr. Simmons Blackboard Collaborate room, we have a Math Academic Help Center Collaborate room where all of our math teachers are set up as instructors, and it's kind of like a pooled office hour. So any math student can go to the Math Academic Help Center whenever there's a teacher available. We have a calendar embedded in the course to show when that availability is, and they can get help. So it expands the number of students that I can help during my office hour time, and it also expands the amount of time that level of help is available for my students beyond just the 1 hour that I can do. So we call that the Academic Help Center. So teachers have to pick one or the other, and then they have to advertise that in their announcements. We also will have some teachers who will submit as a bonus activity, they'll submit a guest speaker or a lecture or something that goes above and beyond that availability requirement. And if they make that available to other courses in their content area, we'll reward that with a bonus as well. So as a minimum, we asked everybody to advertise those as an exceeds requirement. If you're actually hosting a guest speaker or a book talk or something of that nature, we'll reward the teacher with a bonus point there. And then if they make themselves available for additional hours in the Academic Help Center, that's also an additional bonus point. And as you can see on my previous slide, again, the major tool we use for that within Blackboard is Blackboard Collaborate, and then the teachers will advertise those sessions using the announcements and using the email tool within their LMS. Okay. Interventions. So for those students who are falling behind and need some additional help, we do have an intervention requirement for teachers. This always generates lots of controversy with late work and grading late assignments. So this is where we've kind of put the baseline for all IDLA courses. If teachers choose to go above and beyond this, that's fine. They need to advertise that within their course. But they have to accept all work through the duration of the course for at least 50%. So if something comes in beyond the due date of that assignment, teachers have to take it for at least half of the value, up to the last day of the course. We define the last day of the course as the last day of final exam week. And that's the minimum standard that we have for teachers. Many of them will go above and beyond that. We have some teachers who don't take any work, any points off for late work. It kind of depends upon their philosophy and the student and the situation that they're working through there. So again, we can use Blackboard Collaborate to help remediate students who are struggling. And then within the Grade Center, teachers will do a couple of things. Obviously, when they'll use the due dates feature within the Grade Center, so that way if something's turned in beyond that date, the Grade Center will stamp that as a late assignment, and that helps our teacher make sure that they apply the late penalty if appropriate. We'll also have, it's not necessarily an intervention, but maybe more individualization. We'll have some situations where students need to work ahead, and in doing so, we can use the adaptive release feature in Blackboard to enable content for that student ahead of the traditional pace of the class. So they can use that feature to unlock content or assignments or test for a student ahead of the rest of the class while still keeping that hidden from the rest of the class. And here's here's where they would use those two pieces. So altering the course pacing or providing additional instruction or communication, such as some student tutoring sessions. And then professional development. This is a piece that my team leads. We do a lot of this. We have two professional development requirements for teachers. We have a annual conference that we host that they're required to attend. In the past, that's been a variety of things. Last year, this year in June, it was a face-to-face event where we were able to bring everybody in face-to-face. In previous years, we've run that in a hybrid format where we had regional face-to-face events supplemented with some online content, whether it was synchronous or asynchronous. We've hosted completely synchronous summer conferences before, and a few summers ago, we actually hosted that in collaboration with some of the other state virtual schools. So we had a conference schedule. We had speakers, we had breakout sessions. It was all hosted through Blackboard Collaborate. And we had teachers from, I think, six different states in attendance. So that requirement has been delivered in different modalities, but it's still something that teachers have to attend each year. And then the other thing we do is we ask them to complete a course during a 15-month window. So every 15 months they have to complete a course. We offer professional development not only on the use of Blackboard but also on online teaching pedagogy. We offer some that's aligned to Common Core. This next year we're going to focus on digital literacy and provide content that that aligns to the topic of digital literacy to try to help teachers understand that piece of online learning. Or they can qualify as something that meets the INACL standards, or in Idaho, we have a set of Idaho online teaching standards. Teachers can work with me to qualify something alternatively that we didn't offer that still meets those same standards and meet that requirement. So we use Blackboard Learn, obviously, to offer our asynchronous online courses. We can use Blackboard Collaborate for any of the synchronous components. And I included course sites on here. This last summer, we did offer an asynchronous kind of a MOOC for teachers in our state virtual school, as well as teachers from other state virtual schools. And I was able to work with a group of about six schools to build content, host it in one LMS that everybody from all those states could access. We took turns facilitating modules, and it ended up being about a 15-hour experience. So that was kind of cool to get the collaboration and have an LMS that wasn't central to any of our programs that was accessible to everybody within our programs. And a bonus in this area, they can complete more than one course within a 15-month period. Or the other thing we do is we offer monthly synchronous trainings using Blackboard Collaborate. We call those our just-in-time trainings. And those will involve Blackboard training or other pedagogical training. Sometimes it's on an update. One time we had Katie come in and give us a Blackboard upgrade preview. So we'll try to either do something timely with a rollout of technology, or we'll do something that's adding on or building on to topics that we covered at summer conference or that are within our asynchronous professional development. And so if instructors attend three of those within a 15-month period, we'll award them a bonus point there as well. And I think this is the last piece here, parent and student evaluations. So we do collect surveys from both students and parents, and the survey will cover quality of the curriculum, quality of instruction, feedback on the registration process. Did they work with our tech support team? How was that experience? It will cover multiple facets in the organization, and we do sit down as a group and look at that data and see if we can find some areas where we can improve. And we basically, for the teachers, all they have to do is make sure students and parents know how to access that and encourage them to do so. We use a tool that's, I don't think it's native to Blackboard, but it plugs into Blackboard, called Evaluation Kit. and it uses the Blackboard users' rights according to their Blackboard role. So if I'm a student and I go in there, I have access to the student survey. If I'm a teacher and I go in there, I can download my survey results as a spreadsheet or as a PDF and see. We can set it to be anonymous so I can see what feedback my students had and my parents had on my instruction or on the content. And basically, for exceeds expectations on this, for a teacher who averages a score greater than 4 on either the student survey or the parent survey, will award them with a bonus point as well. Okay, so those are the major categories that we have within our IDLA teacher rubric and kind of how we measure teachers for success against those and then the different Blackboard tools that we leverage to enable them to do that. So that's what Lisa and I had planned, but we would be happy to answer any questions that may have come up during our talk.
This has been great, Jeff. I'm looking to see if any other questions have come in. We've answered a few questions throughout, but now's the time to add some additional questions into the QA and chat. So let's give everybody a minute, and this has been wonderful. Let's see. This is from Open Schools BC. Do your teachers sign an agreement, MOU, or contract outlining their responsibilities and expectations? How do you manage that?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So we have an MOU that our teachers sign each year. They're considered part-time employees, so we don't pay benefits or anything like that. And basically just says that they agree to teach what we assign to them, but that we're not obliged to sign them anything necessarily. We definitely try to keep everybody busy. But our teachers are paid per enrollment, so they have a base pay based upon the total number of students that are enrolled in their course after our drop period. And then at the end of the course, if they've met the bonus criteria, we add that on as bonus pay. And we have them sign that once a year every summer. And for the most part, each of our teachers teaches usually teach more than one course per session. We have fall, spring, and summer courses. Most of them are teaching multiple classes. Some of them will only take one because they're kind of busy face to face. But for the most part, we keep those guys pretty busy.
Great. And have you gotten feedback from teachers about, you know, what they like, what they don't like about the process? Can you speak to that at all?
As far as the evaluation process is concerned?
Yeah.
I can speak to that a little bit. You know, anytime you're tying somebody's pay to their evaluation, there can be some sticky points. But for the most part, I think we will review this rubric every year in the spring, and we'll make some tweaks where needed. If we have some changes in our programs or changes in the LMS, we'll try to reflect that upon the expectations. We always include teachers in that group so that they have a say in that. And there are times where that can be challenging, but if you look through most of those expectations, almost all of them are things that are within a teacher's control. You know, how often was I in a discussion board? What was my turnaround time on my grading? Did I make phone calls to kids who were struggling? Did I post multiple announcements per week? Did they include videos? those kinds of things. So it's based upon what a teacher is doing, not necessarily upon what the students are doing. There is the parent-teacher survey or the parent-student survey at the end of the course that's based upon a student output, but most of it's based on teacher output. And so I think that makes it as fair as it can be for that type of situation.
Great. I'm looking to see if there might be any other questions. I'm not seeing any at the moment. So let me go ahead and move forward a couple of slides, but we've got plenty of time to take more questions here. One more, I'm sorry. Have you seen increases in student achievement and student outcome as a result?
Yeah, and we have some data. We'll look at overall student completion rate per course, and that's continued to improve every year. That bar has gone up, and it's not necessarily exclusively because of our rubric and expectations. I think that's part of it. I think part of it is Lisa's team and their work that they've done, keeping our curriculum up to date and making sure the students are engaged. So I think it's been an overall effort. But, yeah, we've definitely seen those student completion rates continue to increase.
And to piggyback that just a little bit, I think like any teacher, the more we teach and the more we have gone through this process over the last 12 years, the better we've gotten. So that's across the board, the quality of the courses, the quality of the teachers, the quality of the instruction, all of that.
Great. I think I saw one other question in here. Sorry, I'm coming to it. Seeing them from all different sources. Are all of the teachers at IDLA like Idaho certified teachers? How do you manage state by state certification, or are they all Idaho certified teachers?
So all of our teachers are Idaho certified teachers. They have to have an Idaho endorsement for the subject they're teaching, and they also have to meet the highly qualified teacher designation for their content area, if that's applicable. The vast majority of our teachers are Idaho teachers that are working in an Idaho school. We have some teachers who are retired or a stay-at-home mom that want to stay in the field, or they're brand new out of the university and don't yet have their first face-to-face teaching position, but most of them are teachers working within a brick and mortar school in the state.
Great. All right. So again, we'll keep answering questions, but I'm going to go ahead and move these forward as we don't have any more at this particular moment. But don't hesitate to add more questions in. This has been wonderful. I want to thank both Lisa and Jeff for a great presentation. Very informative, very helpful. This session, along with the others in this series, will be available through the new BBK12 Live app so that your teachers and yourselves can access PD anywhere, anytime, on demand through the app. We know a lot of times folks can't come to these sessions live. You may have the best intentions, and then the time just doesn't work out. You can catch every session of the series through this app. So you spread the word to download the app and be sure to catch it there. Thank you for participating in today's K-12 Blackboard Innovative Teaching Series session. We are beginning to line up sessions for the spring series, so please let us know if you're interested in presenting or if you have ideas for topics that you'd like to see. You can reach out to me on Twitter at 1KatieGallagher or by email, katie.gallagher@blackboard.com. A reminder that you'll receive the recording from today's session and the presentation slides in a few days by email, and you'll receive an invitation to participate in an online professional learning community designed to augment this series and create an avenue for ongoing collaboration and dialogue amongst educators across the U.S., Canada, and the world. So please accept the invitation and participate in the online PLC. Again, join us next Monday at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for From Zero to Blended with EduBro, Timothy Gwynn. You can go to bbbb.blackboard.com/k12bits to register for that session or any other sessions in the series. We don't have sessions every Friday at noon, but we do have one next Friday. It's going to focus on the achievements tool, which is the way to do badges within Blackboard Learn, as well as adaptive release for personalized learning. So very excited about the presentation today. I want to thank our presenters, Jeff Simmons and Lisa Berry, for a great session, and just appreciate everyone taking time out of their Monday. Have a great week, everyone, and thank you so much.